Hey, what's up? I'm Travis from Poddex. I'm a podcast editor, producer, and a podcast Good Samaritan. And the best advice I ever received is when things aren't adding up, start subtracting.
That's curious advice, Travis. Very interesting. Who told you that, man? When did you learn that in your life?
So my wife told it to me, probably like, I don't know, 6 or 7 years ago. And I know that she didn't make it up. It's from maybe a Brené Brown or some book she read, right? But at the time, I was going through a lot of things and trying to figure out what step to take. And instead of adding something in, she had suggested that I look at what I was already doing and maybe start to make some adjustments in a subtractive nature. And so it hit me so hard, Phil, because this applies to everything you're doing in your life, whether you're a content creator, a business person, your relationship, your workouts, your health, right? Like, when things aren't adding up, you know it. And the first thing you need to do is look at, like, okay, let's use a podcast, for example. I'm podcasting and I'm going crazy because I've got to find guests and I've got to schedule them and I've got to record the content and prepare and edit it. Okay, what can we take out of that to make you a happier podcaster? Do you need to make social media little bites to put on the internet? No. You need to write extensive show notes? No. What can we pull back so we can get back to basics and get back into the groove of what we're doing?
Okay, so do we never add it back?
I mean, no, you can add it back.
Yeah, so talk to me about that. I mean, because here's the challenge, right? So once we find the groove, well, then stuff comes back in and we get hit in the face with that. So talk to me about, okay, so when do we know it's okay to add it back, maybe?
When you're not overwhelmed, when you're not feeling like things aren't adding up anymore. So the idea is that, like, everything's a trap, Phil. Like, there's always a new app. There's always a new widget. There's always a new phone. There's always a new, cool thing that you need to be doing, a trend, keto, this, that, the other thing, right? As a human in 2021, we are just inundated with information. We're inundated with advertisements. We're inundated that we are not enough. And so what we're doing right now is trying to be the best people we can. And what we do is we'll buy a bunch of books, or we'll buy some courses, or we'll get coaching, we'll go to the therapist, we'll go to the gym, we need six-pack abs. And it's like, at some point, it's not working. It's not adding up. And so all you have to do is look at, from a very basic standpoint, I need three things, right? I need food, shelter, and love. Okay, so let's start with those. And then when then you add in maybe, okay, I'm going to start to do some fitness stuff. And I'm going to go like 3 days a week and feel it out. Oh, that's too much? Let's roll it back to 2 days a week until we're in the groove. And then we slowly start adding things back in when we can, to not topple over the Jenga thing of our life,
Wow. Yeah. That's good, man. That's good, right? Get back to our basics. Strip it all away. Three things, right? Food, shelter, love. Okay. I can handle that, right?
Yeah.
That's three things. So that's got to relate to the podcasting that you do, man.
Yeah, absolutely.
So before we go into how that connects, how did you get started even podcasting and being like a podcast Sherpa?
Sherpa, I like that. So I was a touring musician for 15 years. So an extrovert going on stage, essentially telling stories through songs. And at some point when you live a gypsy lifestyle, which I recommend for everyone at some point, you look at everybody around you and you go, wow, you have health insurance and a car and a condo, and I have a dollar in my bank account, but everywhere I go, it's a party, right? And you'd kind of say, okay, I'm going to kind of plant my feet in the soil here. So I gave up that lifestyle and got a big boy job. And so then I had to drive an hour every day to my cubicle. And at some point in time, I don't know the exact moment, but I found podcasts and I would listen to them in my car because I was trying to turn my car into a mobile classroom to be a better person. And I started listening to these podcasts and I was like, these sound really bad, because I'm an audio engineer, because I learned through the process of being a musician how to record music so I could make my own and do that stuff. And I was like, I wonder if I could make a podcast sound good. So I'm going to give you the footnotes here because it's a very long story. Anyway, I went to a mastermind event And there was a guy there who said, I'm really interested in starting a podcast, but I don't know how. So I said, let me help you. And so I just started helping him. I started producing his podcast. And from there, he told somebody who told somebody who told somebody. At one point, I've launched over 125 podcasts for clients. I've never ran an ad for it ever. Okay. And, you know, from there, I was like, I'm out of time. I sold all my time. Now, what do I do now? Well, all the gurus told me, like, make a course, right? Make a course. So I spent 6 weeks making a course that no one had asked for. I rolled it out improperly, and I sold a few. But part of the rollout of the course was that I wanted to use the lumpy envelope strategy. Have you heard of this?
Of course. Okay. Yeah.
So I wanted to surprise and delight my new customers, because I like to be surprised and delighted. So I came up with a deck of cards that had questions that I had on my phone that I called friends questions. And I would whip these out when there was a lull at the party or at dinner parties. And people always tell me, like, dude, you just made this party so cool. This was so much fun. Like, you should do that on TV. Or, you know, they didn't even know what podcasting was. And so I would send people this deck of cards. This is the new artwork here for the cards, but it was just a funny gift. And what happened was, oh, hey there, hey, podcast buddy. People would email me and say, listen, I don't want to buy the course. Can I just buy the cards? And I was like, no, it's not, this isn't. And then about the sixth or seventh email, I said, okay, people want the cards. And I decided to just test it as a business. And I printed 10 decks. I called it Pod Decks. It was the first thing I could think of. And I ran an ad on Instagram that I made on my phone, and I sold out in like 5 minutes. And then I pressed 100 and sold out in an hour. And here we are. I've shipped Pod Decks all over the globe. We now have a mobile app, and it's proof that sometimes the thing that you're doing that you think is the big thing isn't the big thing. So this opened up a completely new world to me, because I had been editing people's podcasts. I didn't tell anybody. I was just doing it. And now people saw this product, and I had the opportunity to engage with them and help them in a way that I hadn't been able to before. And now I have, 6,000 people following me on Instagram looking at the tips, and I have a huge community and a mastermind group I run for podcasters. And it was just this deck of cards opened up the door to me to be accessible to people in a way that was different than everybody else. And of course, I got the goods, man. Let me tell you, I'm fun. I'm studying the industry. I love podcasting and podcasters. So it worked out for me, because I truly do care about creators. And here I am today on your podcast, on your live stream. Like, we're hanging out. So this deck of cards brought people like yourself into my world. And I'm forever grateful for that, because I'm not sure that if I didn't do that, that I'd be sitting here with you right now.
Wow. That's cool, man. That's really cool. I love the accidentalness of the Pod Decks. That's cool. So just full disclosure here, Travis, you did not send me any of these free, you bastard. I bought these.
Well, thank you.
Yeah. No, I bought them. Oops, hold on. I got one more. So I bought your 5 decks, right? I bought your jumbo pack here. And they're cool, man. Like, they make so much sense, and they make podcasts a ton more fun. So because it's my show, I'm going to ask you one of the questions, and then we're going to talk about what makes a great podcast. So so you are musically inclined, so it's funny that this one comes up. If you're musically inclined, who would you want to have a private jam session with, and why?
I would probably go with for a jam session, I would have to go with somebody who plays an instrument. And I think that I would probably go to like a Jimi Hendrix, just because he was so innovative, and his lifespan was so short that, like, you know, who knows what he would have been capable. Like, if Jimi Hendrix was alive right now, who knows what kind of, like, what he would have done to music. And I just think that, like, we probably would have taken acid and jammed out and had some, like, you know, more than a jam session. We probably would have had like a spiritual connecting event. And I think that would sound like, I think that would be my number one answer, would be Jimi Hendrix. Are you a musician?
I am not. Well, I was in a choir in the Navy.
Okay.
So
if you could do a duet, with anybody, who would you do a duet with?
Yeah. So, well, first I'll tell you, my favorite kind of duet wasn't really even a duet. It's James Taylor singing backup on Mark Cohn's song. True Companion. Or okay. No. No, it's not. I don't know. But it's one of Marcon's songs. My brain is not firing fast. I figured you'd spin that around on me. Perfect Love. That's the song off the Marcon self-titled. So okay. James Taylor singing in the background. So I'd love to sing background on a Marcon song. Or if I was going to sing like equal parts, someone that I think I, you know, that I'd love to kind of to harmonize with would actually be the Indigo Girls.
Cool.
They're so much fun. Like their song, you know, The Power of Two is such a great song. Closer to Fine rocks my world. Like they're back together musically. COVID brought them back together to play together. So they had 15 years off. I saw them years ago at the Bridge School benefit. They only played like 6 songs. And both of those songs they played, and a couple songs I didn't recognize because I had not really been familiar with them. I just knew, oh, they play some music, right? That's cool. And so, yeah, when I lived out in Alameda, California, I got to see them. And now I'm like, wow, they're back together. So that's kind of cool, man.
That's awesome.
That's a cool connection. Yeah, thanks. Thanks. So, yeah, so that's, I mean, that's the stuff that's inside these conversations, right? I love that. I would, you know, you could call these conversation decks, but pod decks, interestingly enough, right, makes sense because you're a podcaster. It connects to the brand. And frankly, if you're like, man, this guest kind of, I'm not sure what to ask.
Yeah.
I can pull something out, right? Not everybody can jam in the instant. Some people need prep and some people, frankly, need prompt. So I like these prompts, man. These are pretty cool. But besides that kind of extemporaneousness, what do you think, Travis, makes a good podcast?
Yeah. So, you know, I love everything you said about pod decks, and I think it's true that spontaneity is underrated. And as podcasters, we sort of get into the groove of like what has come before us. We use that as inspiration, but sometimes it falls into a trap that we're almost asking the same questions and doing the same show as somebody else. And so there's two things that I think that could really make you have a great podcast. First is simply vulnerability. So the best podcasts are the ones where somebody shares something that they maybe, like, if you can get somebody to say, I've never told this story before, you have a fire podcast. And the way to do that is you have to be vulnerable yourself to make your guest feel comfortable enough to share something like that. So it works both ways. You know, everyone wants to be the expert, the guru, the seven-figure this, the whatever. But in reality, you know what people really are attracted to is authenticity and like hearing somebody say like, yeah, I really struggled with this and here's what I've learned. And so if you can get somebody to open up, they're going to give you different information than they're going to give on other podcasts. So let me give you an example of this, okay? An author. So you have an author on your podcast. Authors love to do podcasts because they like to sell books. So most people are going to say like, hey, so you know, you wrote this book, congratulations. Like, you know, what made you want to write the book, right? That's going to be the question that they mostly ask. But the way to get an emotional response or a vulnerable response to say like, okay, you're an author and you've slaved over this book. Was there ever a time when you just thought, I got to delete this. I can't do this, or throughout the process where the book didn't come out? Well, now we're talking, because that, if that person did think that, they're going to share, yeah, I had the lowest moment. I almost deleted the file, or I lost it, or, you know, now we have a story that is, everyone thinks they can write a book, right? Like, so you have to think about the ways that you can twist the questions respectfully. You don't want to be digging through people's dirty laundry, but you want to encourage them to let the guard down a little bit and not just be the top of the mountain guy, but like be a person and share that like being a person isn't easy, right? We talked about subtracting, right? There's a lot going on in the world. So if you can get that out, that's one way to make a really great conversation. And I'm sure all your favorite podcasts are the ones that somebody did something similar to that. And, you know, secondarily, just, you know, don't do what you heard on another podcast, which is like, you know, the basic interview. Like, I like this conversation because we're getting a little deeper than, you know, most people ask me the basic questions about podcasting, which is totally fine. I'm happy to answer, but you know, I'm 2 years sober, right? So I could share that with you. And it's like, you know, I had a problem with alcohol, right? So I could be vulnerable with you and we can have a conversation. And this is why I like Poddex, is because the questions may be the same, but the answers are always different. And they're going to take you somewhere that you didn't expect to go. And that's where the magic happens. Like, the example I can use is you know, Bob Ross, Happy Accidents, right? There are no mistakes, there's happy accidents. But a band like the Beatles, the example I use is that they recorded this music and one of the junior engineers took the tape reel, because we used to record the tape, he put it on the machine backwards. And so what happened was, when you do that, it plays the audio backwards, all right? And so he started to play back what they had just recorded backwards. And he was like, oh my God, I'm so sorry, I'm so sorry. He thinks he's gonna get fired. And John Lennon goes, wait, I wanna hear this. And then from then on, John Lennon wanted to hear everything that he recorded backwards. And that's how they implemented some of these things into their groundbreaking material, was by something that was not planned by any means. And so I think spontaneity combined with vulnerability really will give you some incredible content that is different than everybody else.
Wow. That's interesting. I dig that. I like, you know, I try my best to be spontaneous on the show, right? I'm a conversationalist. There's no script here, right? I'm not pulling that out. But the vulnerability is an interesting one. And that's one that often I think maybe I struggle with, because I'm worried about being perfect, right? I want the right show, right? Before we even started, you're like, dude, we got bad reverb. I got to tell you, man, I'm freaked out. I'm like, oh my gosh, like I got to fix this before we go live. And certainly, I mean, I did fix it and I'm grateful that you told me, but you know, I worry about that fear of perfection and wanting to be perfect. So how do we jostle with or battle with the two beasts here between vulnerability and perfection, Trav?
Yeah, I hate perfectionism, because when I think of perfect, I think of a room. It's a room. It's got four walls and a door. And you walk in and there's just white walls and a white floor and everything's clean and everything's perfect. It's a perfect room and it's boring. I want a big old picture of something crazy on the wall, and I want a crack that somebody accidentally fell into and there's a story there. And I want some dust on the floor because somebody was sawing some big thing, right? Perfection is unattainable, and it's not even worth attaining, because at some point you become this sterile thing that has no character. And so, you know, I use this example all the time. I got my picture taken by some photographer, my family portraits. And then we got the pictures back, and she had basically photoshopped all the pockmarks off my face. I have a scar over my eye. And I was like, no, take all that off. That is who I am. I'm not trying to be like this photoshopped thing, but it's really like you need to lean into your imperfections, because those are actually your strongest thing. So another example I could give you, like, let's look at Steve Buscemi. Right, Steve Buscemi is not necessarily your Brad Pitt looking actor. Hollywood asked him to fix his teeth. His teeth are like this. And he said, F you, I'm not fixing my teeth. And he has a weird voice. And he's built a multi-million dollar career from voiceover acting in Disney movies, because he embraced who he was. He didn't try to be perfect. And you see that's your superpower. Like, Phil, you're perfect as you are right now. And you may think, oh, this thing's an imperfection, or this, it's what makes you unique. And if we were all perfect, we'd all be these perfect robots. It's boring. It's like, the beauty of the world is that we all like different things. There's enough for everybody, and that we're all unique. Unless you have an identical twin, you are absolutely a unique person. Does that help you kind of like, mm-hmm. I want to take the handcuffs off you. Like, everything you do is perfect, Phil. It's at the perfect time, in the perfect place, and there's no other answer.
That's cool. I mean, leaning into your imperfections is liberating, right? And I certainly, not that I never do that, but I don't do that enough. And that's a good reminder to do more of that and to make sure that I own that, that I'm okay with that. I mean, I just went to, I spent the last 2 days recording videos so that I can have, you know, put my program together and have a good demonstration of my, you know, of my expertise.
Yeah.
And a lot of that was letting my personality shine through. and making sure, you know, to that point though, we have to kind of practice, I think, owning those imperfections, right? Because the first time, like the first time you might say, well, dude, like, what's that scar? And the first time you might be self-conscious. You might be like, oh, what? I didn't notice that. Or, you know, the first time that somebody says, hey, dude, you got Schmeck on your shirt.
Yeah.
Like, well, oh, yeah, that's awkward. Well, then when you own it, right, we get that. So how do we, as a podcast host, Travis,
yeah,
how do we shorten that time up so that we can get faster at owning those imperfections?
Yeah, you just have to learn how to, okay, let me just give you a tool. Someone else created this thought process, and I don't know who, and I'd have to fact check it, but I think it's like 777. Would this bother me in 7 days? Would this bother me in 7 weeks? Am I going to be worried about this in 7 years? And typically the answer is no. So is it worth worrying about? Because worrying is one of the most toxic things that you can do, right? Oh, I got stuff on my shirt. Yeah, I had this awesome sandwich and it looks like I got a little bit on there, right? That's a good story. You know, I'll get the scar in my eye. Yeah, I earned that scar. A guy punched me in the face in a bar because I accidentally was dancing with his wife, right? That's interesting. A perfect face is not interesting to me at all. Like, you know, like, so if you can, and I'm not saying like go run around telling people like, you don't have to like point out your imperfections. I see this a lot on Instagram where women will be like, oh yeah, I got this pimple right here. And it's almost like they're like, if I show it to you first, you can't like make fun of it. And the fact of the matter is like, yeah, we get pimples. Everyone has gotten a pimple in their life. We get it. Or they'll be like, I'm not wearing makeup. It's like, okay. You look great. You don't have to announce your imperfections, but you don't have to be ashamed of your imperfections, because I believe that those are actually your best features because they make you interesting and unique. So I don't know. You have to learn how to not GAF, and I'm not sure what the language is on this podcast, so I'm just going to keep it at that, but like none of it matters. It's someone else's opinion of you is none of your business. If you can own you and be happy with yourself, you will unlock something so powerful that no one will be able to touch you. Because if you don't care that you got stuff on your shirt, that's all that matters. If you care when people point that out to you, then you're losing because you're giving them your energy. So keep your energy for creation. And listen, if you want to sterilize something, become a like a heart surgeon where everything has to be sterile. But if you're going to be podcasting, get messy. Let the dog bark in the background. Take a breath. Like, people are like, I got to cut the breaths out of my podcast. You breathe, don't you? Who cares? I'll say all the time. I don't care because you know what? That's how I talk. You know, so just be you and stop trying to, stop trying to be. We set these imaginary bars in our life of what we need to be. And you set the bar. No one else did. You said, this has to be perfect. No one came into you and said, if it's not perfect, you die at midnight. We do it to ourselves. So take all of that out of the equation. Just say, I am doing something. And that is enough. And if you're getting better over time, then you're winning. If you're getting worse, then you need to kind of look inward and say, like, what am I doing wrong here? But this is the problem with, you know, the internet. We compare ourselves to other people. We want what other people have, and you can't live someone else's life. And someone is going to be looking at you some point wanting what you have. And you know damn well that you were in their shoes at one point. So let's just all agree to be good people. Don't hurt anybody and just be yourself. And you can have so much fun doing whatever it is that you want to create.
Cool. Be yourself. We can do that. So the question that I get though, and that I guess I have is, so how do we monetize that, Travis? How do we turn our, yay, we're having a great conversation, into cha-ching, right? How do I turn that into something that actually works for my business instead of just a hobby?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think there's a big misnomer with podcasting that your big opportunity is that you grow this audience and then somebody advertises on your podcast. And I don't think that's the big opportunity. It is an opportunity for some people, but for 99% of us, that will not happen. And so the question I like to ask people is, okay, you want to make money on your podcast? I'll give you $1 million to promote racism 3 times a show for the rest of your podcast. Would you do it?
Heck no.
Right. So it's not really about the money. You do have integrity, right? So in my opinion, selling ads or doing CPM and all this other stuff is really like the lowest bit of integrity as a creator you could have. Here's what you can do instead. Instead of thinking of your audience as like, I'm on the stage, you're in the audience, think of them as community members, okay? And think about ways that you can enrich their lives. There's a few that I could mention right away. So first of all, just promoting things that you love and use. Like your glasses game is on point. I'm sure people ask you about your glasses. What's the brand of glasses, Phil?
Zenni.
Zenni, right? So I go to Zenni and I see if they have some type of affiliate program where if I promote them through a link and people buy it, I get a commission. So I'm being rewarded for just sharing with people the thing I love and use. Now people ask you stuff all the time, and you just gotta start making a note of that. That's one income stream. Services. As a creator, as a podcaster, you're developing services, right? So, or you're developing skills, rather. That skill might not be directly correlated to your podcast. Let's say you have an NFL podcast, but you do it with video, and you learn how to make these amazing videos. Well, you could offer your video services as an income stream. It doesn't have to be the sorry, my camera's going to pop back on here. It doesn't have to be directly correlated to the topic of your podcast. The podcast is a door that opens into you as a greater entity, okay? You could do a digital product. I'm so hot on this right now, and you just mentioned that you're doing one, right?
Yep, yeah. That's right.
So check this out. People ask you for help with stuff all the time. How do I make a GIF of myself? How did you do that thing with the video where you did the little animation? Those would all be something that you could create what I call a micro course, where you take someone from step A to Z on one task. Okay, most people think when they make a course, they have to have 70 hours of video, 25 bonus sheets. If you've ever bought a course like that, is the worst possible thing that can happen to you, because you're so excited to learn this thing, and then you open it up and you're like, oh, I got a full-time job watching this course now. Teach people how to do something that they ask you to do all the time, or ask you for help with all the time, quickly and affordably. So if you know how to do spreadsheets better than anybody else, and you're like, I've got these five things that I know how to make your spreadsheet life so much better, mini course, $39, sell it while you sleep. Okay, so but that has nothing. That might not have anything to do directly with your podcast topic. And so that's something that you have to remember, that the podcast, again, door that opens into you. You could do physical products. I sell hats, shirts, mystery boxes. My podcast has made $0. $0. But it lets me connect with my people, okay? And then finally, we're building this community, right? You're not my audience member. You're my peer. So you give people places to hang out. Maybe it's a free Facebook group. Maybe it's a mastermind group. Maybe you create something where people can hang out with you and watch a movie once a month if you're a movie podcast, right? Create opportunities for people to be around you. And yes, at some point you can monetize that. And then finally, a brand may walk up to you and say, we want to promote our thing on your podcast. It's happened to me. It is super complicated. You have to submit a proposal. There's a PO. You don't get paid right away. It takes a long time. And I'd much rather build my own community than to wait around for corporations to come sniffing around my podcast to maybe make some money. Was that helpful?
Yeah, and that's so interesting, because you backed into, or you ended with, the one that most people see. And then when they realize it's so hard and it doesn't make much money, they're like, oh crap, well, this podcast is a waste of time. But if I would back up just one step that you said, and that is giving people access to you, give them an opportunity to hang out with you, create a community, and maybe some, you know, make an offer, right? I mean, maybe yeah. There's a mastermind weekend or something like that, related or not to the topic, that can really help. I really like that. I think those are smart ideas. Of course, you know, products are great. Recognizing your skills translated into services is great, but then your first step about figure out what you love and use already, I think is so darn important and so often overlooked. Finding what you're already using, like look around, look in your space and see what is it about you that people come to you for that you can promote a product or a service. So I think that's awesome advice.
Can I just add one more thing to the community aspect?
Yeah, please do.
Because when I say build a community, we are going to make those people offers, because all the people in our community are our biggest fans, and they're going to be our customers, they're going to be our employees, they're going to be our collaborators. But when you build this community, challenge yourself to just for 3 months, for 5 months, for 6 months, just go in there and talk to them like people and hang out with them and ask them what makes them tick or how you could help them, and show them that you actually care, because we're sold all the time. And so if somebody shows interest in you and then all of a sudden it's a call to buy a $5,000 course, that's not really community. Community is like, I've got your back. You're a part of this thing with me. And we're programmed as human beings to want to be a part of a tribe. So people want to be a part of a community, but you really have to show up and be in that community. You can't just say, go to this Facebook group and hang out with each other. Again, you're their peer. You're their future employer. You're their future collaborator. So be a human and get interested in people, because people are your biggest friends and are going to be your customers.
Yeah. Great advice. Being interested in people is underrated. People don't do that enough. I think they hear, oh, set up a Facebook group, right? They check the box.
Yep.
Like, we could go through step by step, right? Here's how to set up a podcast. Well, you know, you record a 3-minute intro, you submit it to iTunes, you find a place to host your podcast. Maybe you have a website, you release it, you upload. It's like, yeah, that's nice. I mean, technically, I guess that's true, but without a community, you have almost nothing. So Travis, I'm part of your community. I joined your Facebook group. I'm learning from you there. So talk to me about, like, is there an ideal frequency? Do you find that you have to show up at the same time every day? Do you, you know, I mean, what are some tips that you have for actually cultivating that community that maybe I've overlooked?
Yeah. So in my community, I don't have a frequency that I show up. I have a job, which is to, first of all, welcome people to the community, make a big deal out of it, because I'm excited that you're there. Second, I need to try to figure out if there's something you're struggling with right now that I can fix right away. I want to give you that huge win. When you come in my door, I want you to be like, oh my God, this is the place for me. And then I want to introduce you to other people that you could collaborate with. I want to ask you questions to make you think. I want to give you tips and tricks. Everything I do in my group is like a free masterclass for podcasting. And I do it because I actually genuinely care. And yes, I do make offers in the group, but that's not my main focus. My main focus is to go in and to make one connection with one person per day. Am I in there every day? No, because life happens, you know, things are busy. But what I've done is I've created a place that is not just a place to drop a link. Like, we kick those people out of the group. You need to be a person and collaborate. We reward our top contributor every single month with a prize, because I want to reward people who are engaging, talking to other people, starting conversations. So I wish I had a roadmap to do it. I'm just genuinely a curious person and I like people. So I like to go in and try to give people that win. So if you can just think about, like, every person who comes to my group, can I give them a light bulb moment or a win or something that pushes them further towards what they want, then you're doing it right. There's no, don't buy a Facebook course. Just go, like, imagine you're having a party. If you invited people to your house, you'd show them where the bathroom was. You'd offer them an hors d'oeuvre. You would make great conversation. It's just a party on the internet, but you can't invite people to the party and then not talk to anybody, because everyone's going to leave, right? So it's very, I think the internet misconstrues. I think gurus have said, automate everything, get a virtual assistant, don't reply to any of your emails, 4-hour work week. Okay, like, some of those things can be applied, but people are subscribing to your podcast for you. They want access to you. They want to be in your circle of influence. You got to be there. You can't have a VA doing everything for you, because then what are you going to do? Sit on the beach and do what? Be alone? I don't know. It's crazy to me.
Yeah, that's interesting. Well, I think this is a good time. Travis, you're giving folks a gift here. And then I got a final question here. And I love that you do this. This is pretty cool. If folks go to free.poddex.com, you can get a free pod deck from Travis. You just pay for the shipping. I think this is really cool, man. This is a great opportunity for folks to kind of test you out, see what the heck is inside of the, you know, of a pod deck, and get to know that. I really dig that. And that's, you know, you're not going to jump on people. You're not going to spam them. Certainly you're going to try to help. I'm sure there's an invitation to the community. Of course, I'm lame and didn't see the free.poddex.com link before. So I paid for that box, which is fine, right? I'm just saying, I think that's great, man. So talk to me about the why that is your kind of free giveaway instead of, hey, sign up for my newsletter and I can do this. Is this your lumpy
download
mail?
Download my checklist.
Yeah. Right, yeah.
So my thought process is like, there's people that want to start podcasts, or there's people that have started podcasts that are struggling. So I offer the episode deck for free because this basically takes that excuse out of your excuse box, right? I've given you 50 ideas, which is almost a year's worth of podcasts. All you have to do is just pull out a card, look at it, and it'll give you a prompt on what to talk about, what to do. So the idea here is that I want to make it free for everybody because I think podcasting is the best medium, but it becomes complicated by technology and some other things. You don't need technology. You have a phone, it has a microphone. You can talk into it and you can publish on the internet today. You don't need fancy intro music. You don't need fancy graphics. It's all about your voice. So the idea being that like, hey, listen, I'll pay for the deck and you pay for the shipping. Seems like a fair thing to me, where I can make sure that you have this tool in your toolbox to where like, maybe your guest cancels. Maybe you're just not inspired today, but you know there's an element of consistency. You have this, shuffle up, pull a card, start talking to your audience. And the ideas in there are really strategic because they're meant to have you be able to share your thoughts on a topic, but also invite your audience to maybe go to your Facebook group and share their thoughts, like your top three books that you gift, right? Well, my three are going to be different than your three, but your three might be three that I haven't read and that I want to go by. So we start this conversation with our audience. And I truly believe that every person deserves to podcast. And I think it's sort of, every person's so unique and has so much experience that you don't know your impact yet. There's a butterfly effect. I may say something to you on this live that really hits home with you. And you may go out and repeat it to another person that it saves them some pain in their life. And then they start a podcast and they're helping somebody. It just goes on and on and on. And you have unique stories regardless of what life you've had. You have experiences that no one else had. And you can do a lot of damage, like in a good way, through podcasting. So I want everybody to start and try it. And I think it's the best and easiest medium and the funnest medium to use to grow your exposure to the world.
I love that. So at free.poddex.com, you can get Travis's free episode ideas, a whole year's worth of content, which I think is a great gift, man. So Travis, I'd be remiss if I didn't ask you one of your questions to close the show here.
Okay.
Because you gave us how to get started right there, right? Just pick up your phone, no excuses, no BS. So let's close with this one, man. One of the questions you have is, what gives you butterflies in your stomach? You're a former musician, now you podcast. I'm going to guess that it's probably not what a lot of people have. So tell me, what gives you butterflies in your stomach, Travis?
Yeah, so as an extrovert, this does not scare me, but I have a lot of empathy for people who have not been on the mic, and it seems scary. That's why I create these tools for people. But what gives me butterflies in my stomach is coming up with new ideas or new offers or new things that I think will bring surprise and delight. So I mentioned I just ran a mystery box. So I do this every once in a while where I basically offer a mystery box and I fill it up with all kinds of cool stuff for podcasters, right? And so you don't know what you're going to get, but there's a bunch of awesome prizes that you could get. Well, I get butterflies in my stomach after I send them out because I ask people to unbox them and share the experience. And so I get to watch people open these things. It's like watching your children open presents on Christmas Day. It's like, I'm so excited to see the reaction and if they're excited and if I've over-delivered, which is something I always try to do. And so I think like what gives me butterflies in my stomach is seeing the joy in another person's face based on something that I've created out of my head or an idea or a concept that I thought like this would make me excited. Maybe it would make someone else excited. And, you know, I'm a lifelong learner. I love creating new things. I'm a creative person. That's who I am, and I'm not going to fight that. And so every new idea gives me more excitement to keep going and to innovate and to do all that stuff. So that's my best answer at this point.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, great stuff. So folks, if you want to connect with Travis Brown, the creator of Poddex, you can go to poddex.com, or better yet, go to free.poddex.com. Get yourself a free gift from Travis. Get yourself the episode ideas, and then get started. Start recording your podcast, and then let Travis know. He loves to hear from folks. He's super responsive. He's Poddex, P-O-D-D-E-C-K-S, pretty much everywhere. And every time that I've interacted with you, Travis, including today, I've learned something. And I've
thank you so much for having me, Phil. And I just want to let everybody know, like, Phil puts a lot of work into this show. And if you're watching on YouTube, subscribe to this channel. If you're listening on a podcast, go give a 5-star review. This is something super simple that you can do to help creators keep going and keep getting exposure. And it's just, Phil deserves it. He deserves a 5-star review or a subscribe right now. So just, it's free, and it's something you can do to support a creator. And I would recommend that you do that right now.
Thanks, Travis. And Dan Gentry got his deck. I'm sure many more. Ben Lichtenwallner was on. He loves the Indigo Girls like I do. And Travis, you're a gift, man. Thanks for being with me today. Thanks for sharing so much insight. I so appreciate you.
Thanks, Phil. You be well.
You too.